Good afternoon to all. Warm welcome to the TIPS Echo session. So, following the last day theory communication class, we are planning to do a practical session on communication. So, today is the faculty is Dr. Rajagopal. I invite Dr. Rajagopal to take over the session, sir.
Hello, everybody.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon. 1, 2. Three. Okay. Three smiles. Keena, you are not smiling. Dr. Bharat, we want some smiles.
Yes,
we want to start with some happiness.
Yes, sir.
Yes, very good. Very good. Good to have you all with us. I know that you had a session on communication last week. And we are following that up. To start with, Shiva, can I have that single PowerPoint showing Spike's protocol? By the way, am I audible to everybody? Can you all hear me well? Yes. Okay. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
You see it. You can all see the screen. You see two names at the bottom where the reference is given. There are two names, Bale and Buckman. I don't know who Bale is. But Mothman, I just wanted to share with you, is a legendary figure in communication with regard to palliative care. Robert Buckman is a Canadian, and his work in the area of emotional support has helped us all to learn a lot. So sometime when you find a few spare minutes, Google for Robert Buckman and you will learn a lot. Buckman was the one who said many years back, maybe some 20 years back, that Harrison's textbook of internal medicine has some 140 chapters. Buckman said there is one chapter missing. That is, what should we do when all the treatment advised in all the 140 chapters fail? That is the chapter of palliative care. He is the one who is the author of the Spikes protocol. That is rather manipulated, but I know that you dealt with it last week. So we'll just go through the whole lot. So starting from the top, everybody please contribute a sentence with me. Vajja, can you unmute Vajja?
Yes, sir.
Vajja,
yes,
can
sir.
You tell me anything important regarding the setting that we draw in communication?
Yes, sir. The setting should be without any disturbance, and it should be a little privacy should be there, because the patient can talk and we also can explain the patient, and the level of eye contact which we maintain should be at the level of the patient, sir.
Okay. So how about the way Shiva and I are sitting?
Yes, sir. At the same level, sir.
Same level, but we are...
Same level of icon.
Maybe...
No, if, the patient should...
Be able to tear a little bit and face each other at least partially, that will be good, right?
Yes, sir. We should face the patient, sir.
And this...
And there should not be any barrier between the patient and the person we are speaking.
Like a table.
Yes.
And this setting is okay with a few people around us?
No, sir.
What's the problem?
The patient might not be comfortable. Unless and until if the patient's relatives are there, that's okay. But if the other people are there, the patient will not be comfortable, sir.
So reasonable privacy is important. Right. So, Vajja, yes, what will you do if you have three residents with you who have come on a posting in palliative care, three medicines from India? So, every time you want to communicate properly to a patient, will you send the residents out?
I couldn't hear you, sir.
If you have three internal medicine residents from CMC,
okay, sir,
doing a rotation with you,
yes, sir,
they are come to learn with you and you want to communicate, yes, with them, will you send your students out?
Hello.
Did you get the question?
Sir, your voice is breaking, sir. Sir?
Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So I'll repeat the question, Raja.
Yes, sir.
If this was the room and I
yes,
had the residents working with me,
yes, sir,
coming to
yes,
learn
sir,
with me, they are there.
Yes, sir.
Are you saying that I should send all of them out?
No, sir. No, sir. We can explain the patient that we are all belong to one team. We'll help you regarding the process of the disease, sir. We can tell the patient like that.
Okay. I mean, a word of explanation is good.
Yes.
And sometimes, yes, not every day, sometimes she is seems reluctant to share something. I may actually ask her, can you please leave the room and allow us to talk to each other? That's not every day. But they,
yes,
I would repeat, they should be sitting down. If there are four people standing and staring down at the patient, it is distracting.
They
are free to be there behind us, like pieces of furniture, and not moving about and distracting, so that I am able to concentrate on the patient. Okay, right. Some compromises are necessary. Very good. Thank you, Vajja. Can we go back on?
Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you. Gina, you want to go next and tell me something about what you understand by B, perception of the condition and seriousness.
Sir, I assume that means that we should have an idea about the history of the patient, the previous interventions, if any, if it was, if needed staging of the disease. We should have talked to the previous treating physicians for who was currently treating, if any.
Absolutely. Very good. Very good, Gina. Yes, we should know all that. Whatever information we should have known, we should have collected. But Gina, in this context, we are talking about the perception of the condition and perception of the seriousness of the condition by the patient. So what that means is that before giving Shiva any information, I should first find out, Shiva, tell me.
Ask.
What is it that you understand about your problem? You said you had back pain. Why do you think you have the back pain? Have the doctor told you anything? Okay. So the question is asked in a non-threatening fashion. Your face conveying empathy. And before giving Shiva any information, I have to understand what she knows. Okay. Say, yes. This may bring out that they know something, but if they have never suspected that it's incurable, and if you bring the question of incurability like a bombshell without preparing her, that would be inappropriate. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Invitation from the patient to give information. Hina, would you like to come in and say what you understand from that? It's okay if you cannot remember. This was from a week back. That's perfectly okay. If you know what it means, you tell me.
Patient to give more information about the case history and all.
Uh-huh.
Or we have to be somewhat familiar with the patient so that he can tell us a detailed history.
If Shiva is my patient, she has a right to know what she has. She does not have a responsibility to know. A proportion of your patients may say, I don't want to know anything, doctor. I don't want to hear anything. Just give me the treatment. That means they are saying that now, in my mind, I am not ready to get the facts. I am scared. I don't want to face the situation. I am not ready to face the situation. At that time, forcing the diagnosis or prognosis on the patient would be inappropriate. I shall have to ask Shiva. Shiva, so you said you do not know what to have. But do you really want to be present? Are you anxious to know what you have? So she may say yes, or she may look doubtful. If she is looking doubtful like this, I may explain. Look, some people want to know everything. They will say, tell me all the facts. Some people may tell me, I don't want to know. Just give me the medicine. What kind of person are you? What do you want? That would be my question. I will wait for an invitation from Shiva for me to give her information. Okay. Dr. Bharat, would you like to tell me what you mean by giving knowledge, giving medical facts? Any point, okay, it's very obvious, but any fact, anything more that you want to add there?
Sir, first, before giving any medical facts, I would like to ensure that patient is comfortable. Comfortable by means, I should allay his suffering. If he is in pain, I should first relieve his pain. If he has any other complaints, that should be treated. So he should be in a comfortable position to have a conversation, and he should be receptive to what I am saying. So once that has been ensured, depending on what the stage of disease has been worked out, I will try to explain him the expected course or the expected prognosis. That does not, things which I am not sure of or I don't know, I will simply answer no for those questions. So it's... I will just, if I have an adequate knowledge and adequate workup before having an interaction, according to that workup, I will give if any statistical facts I am having, what percentage he is likely to have progression to this stage or similar facts. So these medical facts will be delivered to him depending upon what is his knowledge, what is the level of understanding, and how much he is receptive to know about regarding the prognosis of his disease. And that all after treating his ailments which are making him at unease.
Very good. I mean, if the patient is rolling in pain, me giving a lecture at that time will not enter his brain. I have to make the person as comfortable symptomatically as possible. And we already said, okay, I have to understand how much she knows, how much she wants to know. I'll make sure that she is giving me permission to talk. Suppose I can do it in two ways. One thing is that you had all the facts. Like what you have is a prolapse of your discs in between lumbar 3, 4 and 5 vertebrae. This is impinging on your nerves and that is causing your radicular pain. What do you think about my way of presenting those facts?
You have used some medical terms which patient may not understand. So we should explain him in a layman's language if depending on his understanding. So I should tell him that.
Very good. I mean, Bharat, thank you. That is, we should avoid jargon. Almost every word that I mentioned was a medical word. We should translate that to plain language that a layman can understand, right? Thank you. And you said at every step, we'll check for understanding. If I give a lecture about disc prolapse and how it causes nerve root compression, etc., 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 and after the third sentences, she must be thinking, oh my God, what is this all about? Am I going to be paralyzed? Once that thought enters her brain, she will not be listening to me anymore. I will go on with my lecture, but it may not enter her brain. So as Bharat said, I should stop after every single fact that is delivered. Check what she has understood. Check whether she has any questions. Check whether she wants to know more and then proceed step by step. Thank you. Very good.
Sir, just I want to make some mood lighter by it's just like we must have seen that Anand movie. He says it's lymphosarcoma of intestine. So the patient, although he was in a jolly mood, he says, oh, so much big name for a disease, it must definitely be a bigger disease. So like prolapse disc, nerve root compression, and these all things, as many medical terms we use, the patient will think that it's a severe disease or a grave disease, and so that might affect his understanding.
Very good, excellent. E stands for explore emotions and empathize. Somaraju, would you like to say anything that you remember from the last session regarding that exploring emotions and empathizing? Any comments about that?
Sir, in this, while dealing with such kind of patients, sir, it is a matter of high significance that we need to explore the patient's emotional conditions, sir, which are associated with the suffering and with his understanding about disease. And once we explore the patient's emotions, sir, it is also absolutely appropriate on our part to empathize with patient's feelings, sir. That is very, very important, sir. So like we have to use very, very, we have to be very cool. I mean, we have to be cool and composed. And also we should be absolutely we should be, first of all, not the patient, sir. We should be in a very, very receptive mood. And then we need to not just sympathy as the outer, sir, but we need to empathize the patient's feelings. For example, saying that I really understand what you are going through. Simultaneously, we need to support his emotions also, sir. It is not like we are not supposed to condemn his emotions. So it is like one-to-one understanding, not actually like a doctor and patient, things like that, but like a friend or like a family member. We need to empathize with the patient's feelings to get the best outcomes.
Good, very good. I mean, like, suppose after the information that I have given to Shiva is looking very anxious. How would I express empathy? Oh, you poor thing, you must be, I have made you very sad. How about that? No, Vajja doesn't agree.
No, sir. Actually, we are not supposed to use such kind of words.
Why not?
Why are you looking so sad? Like that, such kind of things you are not supposed to use, sir. We should actually say, I can understand your feelings. You are able to in the given situation, I should appreciate your confidence levels, and I should appreciate the attitude in which you are. Like that, we have to use some supporting words instead of saying that, why are you so sad? And things like that you are not supposed to use.
So, sympathy, if saying you poor thing would be expressing,
yes,
sympathy, which may actually be worsening the suffering. So, how about this? I give you some information and looks to me that you are feeling a little anxious. That's it. That would be acceptable. Saying what you see.
Sir.
Did what I tell you make you feel a bit scared? That's acceptable. That would be more like empathy. Saying what you see is okay. But you poor thing, that kind of empathy is traumatizing.
Okay.
Somaraju, I only have one point which I might like to modify. Tell me, can you really understand what is going through Shiva's mind? We can try to understand. Empathizing means we are trying to put ourselves in her place, but still knowing fully well that I can never be in her position. So rather than saying I understand, which may make her feel, you cannot understand, you simply cannot understand my position. Maybe it may be better to see. I see that both the information I gave you is a very difficult one. The information I have given you some bad news, it must have caused you a lot of worry. Something like that may be acceptable. But maybe that, it is not the end of the world, even if you say, I understand, but maybe that's not the best expression.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So, Nalada, any comments about the last, yes, strategy and summary? You are not audible, unmute, please. So we have some technical stack, we cannot hear Swarnalada. So Swarnalada is paid at the chance. Can I ask somebody else? Harpreet, you are there? Harpreet? No. Prashant? Prashant, would you like to talk?
Hi, good afternoon, doctor.
Good afternoon.
Yeah, so I just joined in, so I don't.
I'm sorry. I got to the wrong person. My apologies. So we have two people who have, whom we have not been able to unmute. That is Harpreet and Swarnalatha. Harpreet, now you.
Hello.
Hello. Harpreet, now you are on.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Sir, I couldn't attend the last lecture, so okay. I'm.
So yeah. I will fill it. Harpreet, I will fill it.
I just came from OT now. I just joined in.
Harpreet, you heard the today's session of review of the six steps protocol. The strategy and summarizing is very important.
Yes, sir.
This is where we plan the follow-up action, communicating that to the person. And then eventually summarizing is very important. So the important points that I told you so far are that you have such and such a problem. That the most positive point here is that we can relieve your, we most probably can relieve your pain effectively without significant side effects. That we'll be here to help you, that we'll be seeing you at least twice weekly, and we'll work together to make you as mobile as possible. Something like that. That summary is important. With that introduction, shall I ask for any question from the group? Anybody has a question about this? If not, okay, I'll wait for a minute. Yes, Sabajan.
Sir, in the perception of the condition and seriousness, we are asking for the patient. We do even consider the perception of the condition of the relatives by the side, because we just not only talk to the patient.
Okay.
We do handle that.
Sabajan, would you first talk to the patient? Or would you first talk to the family? Or would you like to talk to all of them together? Would you like the family to be present, or would you like to talk to the patient alone?
I would like the family also to be together, sir.
Vajja, so I get that. But should it be what you wish, or should it be what the patient wishes?
It's the patient wish, sir.
Can you think of a situation where the patient may not want the family with them? Very,
yes, sir.
Very frequent. They have questions to ask. They want to ask, Doctor, am I going to die? Yes, they may not want to ask that in the presence of the wife and the son.
Yes, sir.
I give them the option. Do you think we could, if you want to talk to me alone? And sometimes people say yes, and sometimes people say no. Their choice. Okay. Sometimes families block communication. If the family is also there, but you have an important point, thank you for making it. The family is also there. After finding out the patient's perception, you may ask the others. But if the family knows some things that the patient does not know, do you think they will say it outright?
No.
They may be tucking at my sleeve and say, don't tell them.
Yes.
Now, right at this point of time, maybe later on this afternoon, we'll go on to that issue of pollution. Right now, we are keeping it simpler. Now,
yes.
Whether the family is there or not depends on the patient's wish. Very often the patient may feel supported with the family, but very often the patient may feel handicapped with the family.
Thank you, sir.
I want to show you a video of one communication of bad news. The patient was real, but not the person that you see in the video. That was not the real patient. But the story is real. This was a young woman with an esophageal cancer who is a single mother, and the brother was very protective, the brother always blocked proper communication, and therefore it was difficult to get proper communication with the patient. Eventually the brother's collusion was broken by repeated sessions, and then the doctor was talking to the family, to the patient directly. So the doctor was talking to the young woman who does not know that she has cancer. Okay. Ready for the video. Can you all hear and see? What is it?
Shalini, how are you today?
I'm still finding it difficult to swallow, doctor. The pain is a little better with the medicines you gave me, but the swallowing, I'm getting worried.
Shalini, what do you think is happening to you?
Doctor, how will I know what's happening to me? None of the other doctors told me anything. I used to sit outside. They would talk to my brother. I just keep wondering why I'm not getting better, why I can't eat like I used to be able to. How will I know?
Did you want to know?
Of course I want to know. It's not easy sitting outside and waiting and wondering. My daughter is there. She's getting married 6 months later, and if I can't eat, how will I be there for her wedding?
Is that your major concern at the moment, being there for your daughter's wedding?
Yes, doctor. She's the only one I have, and I have to settle her. It's the most important thing to me.
What's your own impression about what's happening to you?
I'm worried that it may be something serious.
And when you said something serious, did you have any particular disease in mind?
No.
Shalini, I am afraid it is indeed something serious. In fact, what you have is a kind of cancer.
Not cancer, doctor. Not cancer. I could have born anything else, but cancer is the most horrible disease there is. Please tell me it's not cancer.
What I told you is indeed a very difficult thing to hear. I understand that you are considerably burdened by that bit of information I gave you.
I'm scared of cancer, doctor. It's terrible.
Why did you say it's terrible? I mean, did you have some personal experience with a friend or a relative or a neighbor or something like that?
When I was a child, my uncle got cancer. He had a horrible growth coming out of his neck. I used to be so scared of him. And then it started smelling. There were worms coming out. He used to scream in pain. None of us went near him. I can't go through that, doctor.
When I said cancer, Was that what was going through your mind? Something ugly with the worms crawling over it and a lot of pain and all that. I can assure you that it is not going to be something like that. Shalini, there are many forms of cancer. And what you have is not going to show outside. There's going to be no disfigurement. There are going to be no worms. And we are going to take care of your pain.
Are you really sure, doctor?
That's something that I can really assure you of. When your mental impression of cancer was something really dreadful, but things have changed in the last so many years since your uncle's time, and now we can take care of your pain. I know you are finding it very difficult to swallow something. That's something that we'll address. We'll find a way of getting some food into your stomach so that you will feel a bit stronger and less tired then.
Doctor, can I ask you something?
You do.
How long will I live?
I am afraid I don't know the answer to that.
Doctor, you don't have to be afraid of telling me the truth. I can face it. I need to know because of my daughter.
Charlie, one thing that I promise you is not to lie to you. I'll give you an honest answer, and honestly, we do not clearly know how long you can survive. Let us certainly hope that it can be a considerable time ahead, especially when we get the food into you and when we take care of your pain. But on the other hand, things could go wrong. It could be much less. And therefore, maybe it's good to be prepared for that. I actually talked to Arjun, your brother, and I was wondering whether it's possible to bring your daughter's wedding forward. And he thought it could well be possible.
My brother said that?
Yes, he did say that it was a possibility, but he wanted me to talk to you first.
No, if we could have the wedding, that'll really take away half my worries.
Okay. That was a 7-minute conversation. I was alone with Shalini. I was tweeting with her brother's permission. You remember that I asked her what she knows. I asked her whether she wanted to know. I gave a warning shot. Said it seems. I asked her what's her impression. She didn't know. I gave her a warning shot. Told her it was something serious. Then I brought out the word cancer. Was it okay? Should I have said the word cancer, or should I have? Was that a little too blunt? Suppose I had told her, okay, you have a growth there, and avoided the word acute cancer. Would it have been better?
Seeing the educational status of the patient, it appears that she understand, and moreover, the cancer is so common word that a majority of population are aware about it. So telling a growth will be more confusing to the patient. What type of growth, and there are multiple questions will arise after that.
That is Harpreet's opinion. Does anybody have any other opinion there? Harpreet, if I use the word growth, the only favorable argument in favor of saying a growth is taking it gradually. I totally agree with you, Bharat. It is important to bring out the word cancer, because leaving it ambiguous will still leave her in anxiety. What is this growth? Eventually, if she was ready to know, I have to tell her. It's okay to start with something serious. it's a growth, it's a tumor, it's a cancer. So long as you get there eventually, it's okay. Giving it in small boluses and not the whole dose together is acceptable. But eventually the important point is what you want to communicate, we should not run away from. So long as the person is willing to listen to it and wants to listen.
Okay, sir.
That video also brings out one of the problems of not having the whole information. When she heard the news of cancer from me, she was able to bring out her fears and anxieties, her impression of her uncle's cancer with maggots crawling around. If I had avoided disclosure of bad news, she may have heard the news from somebody else. You know that very frequently happens. Everybody hides the news, thinks everybody agrees that we wouldn't call her. Then a cousin comes in to visit and says, "Oh, Chachi, you have cancer, how dreadful," etc. So that is one way. I also know of a child who knew he had leukemia, but did not know that the leukemia was cancer. And everybody avoided the word cancer for several weeks. Then one nurse told the attendant, "Give this to that cancer child in the corner there." And that's when Pradeep heard for the first time that he had cancer. It comes as a shock. There is no opportunity for asking questions. And by giving the news in a compassionate way, with empathy, with the opportunity to ask questions, we are avoiding that kind of shock and unspoken questions and unspoken anxiety. Anything else from that conversation, that positive or negative, that you want to comment on? Anybody?
So initially the patient was anxious about the marriage, everything, because you spoke to the brother and when you told that the marriage can be preponed, so she was little comforted, not fully, but she was like, she was hoping, yeah, things will get settled, because by the end of the conversation, she was like, if the marriage is there, I'll be little relieved, my all burdens will be better, I'll lose, the burdens will be loosened. So that was a positive thing. So finally, the conversation was successful.
So thank you, Vajja. Vajja's comment also brings out an important point. Very often we have to get verbal news. Not at all easy to take out. When that happens, when you have to give a bad news, it's always important to highlight and emphasize the most positive point in the situation. Like for that Pradeep, the child with leukemia, the message should have been, yes, you have cancer, but it is a cancer with a very good chance of complete cure. Did I give any such positive reassurance to this girl apart from the question of bringing forward the wedding? Was there any other attempt at emphasizing a positive point in the situation?
So there was a point in which you mentioned that we will ensure that you will, if the eating is a problem because she's not able to swallow, we will see that you can eat well. Like, we'll, that was a positive point, sir.
Well, we said eating is another thing that I was not sure. So instead I said, we'll find a way of getting food into I was not sure whether it will have to be a gastrostomy. Okay, so I mean, like, very important not to give false reassurance. By seeing Shalini's pain, he wants to help her. I am very tempted to give her promises. But it's important not to give any promise that I cannot keep. Because if I do, then the letdown and the depression will be enormous. So I should avoid false reassurance. Yes.
Sir, one more thing was that we had told her that there will be no disfigurement like the what his uncle had. There won't be no much maggot. So, although everybody is anxious of his appearance, particularly females, so probably that is also some reassurance we have given.
If it was a horrible thing on the face, I had actually a patient like that who, a woman, middle-aged woman, who did not allow anyone to come to her room, including her husband. The only person allowed into the room was her sister-in-law. Daughter-in-law. The daughter-in-law was the carer and only she was allowed to, because she did not want anybody to see her like that. I remember a nurse who just helped her by helping the family to fashion a kind of bandage, just a piece of thing that she could slip up over the ear so that this was covered. Once the thing was easily covered by a dressing, she looked at the mirror. And thereafter, she was willing to allow her relatives to come in and see her because she was not so ugly anymore once it was covered. So, we find the most positive point in the situation. And did you notice that that was not a complete video? The conversation was interrupted. What was to be added? What did you not see? What more should have happened? Certainly, the treatment plan should have been discussed and agreed upon. And finally, a summary should have happened. Okay. So, with that introduction, shall we go on to the presentation of a real life situation?
Sir, I have a question.
Yes.
Hello.
Yes.
Sir, the patient asked that how long she's gonna live, and suppose if you know that it's around say 1 or 2 months the lifespan, then should we tell to the patient or give a more sympathetic answer, or should we tell her straightforward?
Does anybody else want to answer that question?
Sir, I think if the patient's main priority is if the patient wants to know, then the patient should be given that care.
She deserves the truth if she wants to know. I agree, Gina. Do you know the truth? Do you know how long she will live? You can give statistics. Like 80% of people with like you live only for 3 months. Doctors, oncologists are familiar with patients with whom they have made a mental prediction of 3 months or 6 months. And then a year and a half later, they come and open the door and say, "Hey doctor, I'm still here, I'm not dead yet." The problem with statistics is you quote statistics only for the person who wants it. What did I say about the prognosis? I don't know how long you have. I was talking vaguely about let us hope for the best, but also prepare for the worst. That should be the general message. Here I am treading in more dangerous waters, and I'll ask Melanie if she has any comments, and Sunil if he has any comments. But my point is this. I give so much of information. There are some people who work very much with their head and numbers. They may ask, okay, doctor, I know that you cannot be sure, but what are the chances? Do I have 50% chance of being alive for 6 months? If somebody does want to know that kind of statistics, I will have to say, look, in 80% of patients with this kind of condition, the average life expectancy is only so. But then I'll emphasize that. But it is very likely that in the remaining 20%, it can be much longer, and sometimes our prediction can go very wrong. Therefore, let's hope for the best. But on the other hand, sometimes it's also possible that things can take a turn for the worse pretty fast. Therefore, let us prepare for that. Do you have any unfinished business? Why did you ask? Did you have some things to do with the time you have? And okay, those are things. Maybe you don't need to do it just yet, but it's much better to do those things right now so that you will feel more at peace. That would be my life. Sunil, comments? Hello?
I guess just along the lines of why did you ask, or do you have things you need to do? A wise surgeon, and surgeons have to break bad news often to cancer patients, would answer the patient's question about prognosis by how much time do you need? Once more, putting it back to the patient's priorities.
Yeah. Somebody will handle that. He'll bring it there, there, Shiva. Somebody was coming out with a case presentation today. Shiva, who is it? Harpreet? We had a problem unmuting her, right? That could be a major.
Yes. Hello.
Okay.
Should I start?
Yes, sir. Pray.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
So I'm presenting a case.
Yes.
A 36-year-old male patient presented with 3 months history of 3 into 2 centimeter swelling right side of neck. Which was gradually progressive. There was no history of any previous surgery, radiation, or any family history. On ultrasound, it was a solid 14 to 18 and 24 mm hypodense lesion with irregular edges in right lobe of thyroid. And right side neck nodes were also seen. And on FNSC, the features were suspicious of malignancy. Next slide. Based upon the FNC features and ultrasound, the total thyroidectomy with right side neck dissection level 2 to 5 was done. But upon final histopath, it came out to be anaplastic carcinoma of thyroid. And further plan is being considered radiotherapy plus minus chemotherapy. Now some points to consider are that anaplastic thyroid is most aggressive thyroid cancer. It's itself stage T4 and mean survival of around 3 to 9 months with 2 year survival 10 to 15%. And facts about the patient are that patient is a 37-year-old shopkeeper. He's a sole breadwinner in the family. He has 2 children, 5 father and mother to take care of. And the patient, pre-op the patient was counseled that the disease is suspicious to be malignant on FNAC, but overall survival is good. However, the histopath report came yesterday and relatives were informed regarding everything about the disease, its prognosis and all. And relatives told us to not tell patient anything right now, and they themselves were shocked. And patient is still in ward waiting to know the report and to get discharged. So here the questions I need to ask is how to break this bad news to the patient and relatives, And should the patient be told everything on the same day, irrespective of the family's opinion? When to tell the patient if you agreed to not do so on the same day? And is it right to let the patient get discharged without telling the patient if the family wants to keep it a secret from the patient? And if we do so, what are the legal implications? And how, this is the most important thing, how to explain this sudden change of prognosis or when things don't go the way you expected?
No.
And
yes, Atreid, you wanted to say something more?
Yes, so the patient report actually came 2 days back. So we, upon the agreement of the family, we told the patient about the disease and prognosis. But at first, the relatives were not wanting to tell the patient right away. But finally, they agreed.
Okay, thank you. This is very familiar. So, very familiar situation. And sometimes some of the answers may be different in Delamese country, that's New Zealand and here. Because the truth is, if I antagonize the family, I almost invariably lose the chance of helping the patient. It's next to impossible to continue to help the patient. So I am very interested, Harpreet. The first day the family was not willing for disclosure, but the second day when they came again, they became willing. What caused this change? Do you know?
So they were counseled, the family was counseled that the patient should be told. So they also were in a bit of dilemma to whether to tell or not. But upon some little bit counseling, they agreed.
What exactly was involved in that counseling? Were you telling them that no, patient has a right to know? We have to tell them. We have the duty to tell them. Is that what you did?
Yes, we told that it's a patient. He has to know about his disease and what next can be done. What is the prognosis? So they agreed upon saying these things.
So Harpreet, imagine I am the patient's family member. I am telling you, doctor, please don't tell him. And you are telling me that no, we have to tell him. He has a right to know.
Yes, sir.
And, okay, so I am telling you, Harpreet. Doctor, he is my cousin. I know him. Or she is my wife. I know her. You don't know her. She cannot take such a bad news. She'll be depressed and she will not get out of the depression. So please don't tell her. So how do you react to that statement?
So that is actually one of my questions which I want to ask.
Okay. Very good.
What to do in such scenario when family members are not willing to disclose the information?
Harpreet, I have a strategy for such situations. When there are difficult issues, I hand it over to somebody else to solve. So I am calling upon Sunil, and you all know Sunil. Sunil is our additional director of our institute. And Sharath. Sharath is our senior medical social worker. I am asking them to do an enactment. They are going to do a role play. Will you explain who is the patient's family member and who is the doctor?
Sharath is this patient's wife. Can you hear us?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so Sharath is patient's wife.
Yes, I can hear you.
I am in your situation. I am Dr. Sathya.
Okay.
and the person says, how can we help you?
So actually, doctor, I'm in a confusion.
I didn't get your name. Can you tell me?
My name is Vinny Dutta, his wife. So I came here to meet you personally. So I think you are planning to start for him. He's not completely aware of his condition. So yesterday I think you had a conversation with my father. So he said he and we also feel that we should not tell anything to him because he may not recall that information. So I came here personally to make sure that it should not happen accidentally from you. So I wanted to tell you that. That's why I came here. Whether everybody can hear. Okay. Can you all hear us?
Sir, I cannot hear you. The voice is breaking. Is there a problem with my net?
Patient's voice is clear.
Doctor, I came here to meet you personally. You said we can go home tomorrow, but I'm really confused. He doesn't know about the illness. Actually, we didn't want to disclose that to him. Because we feel that my husband, he may not withhold that information. So I think you already had a conversation with your father. So we, all the family members feel that we should not tell anything to my husband. So I came here that should not happen accidentally when you are meeting him next. So we should not tell anything to him. Please, doctor.
Okay. So that thought has been worrying me.
Yes, doctor. I couldn't sleep. I couldn't go home. What should I tell him if he asks? Because I don't know.
Okay, Vinita. I agree with you that without your permission, we are not going to tell him regarding the diagnosis. Can you tell me why you don't want us to tell the diagnosis?
Because Dr. Smith is such a light-hearted person. He can never report such a horrible information because he may go into depression. I don't know. He may think about suicide because I know him very well. So I'm really afraid of that. But we already have him. So I'm really scared, doctor. That's why.
Okay. So this thought will worry you. That's right. Because we are giving some bad news.
Yes, that's right.
Okay. So it is going to worry him, but we don't know the other things like depression or things like that. But it is going to be make him somewhat sad. But let's not assume, but it's a bad news. You are right.
Yes, doctor.
So, what have you told him about the disease till now?
I told him that there is a mass over his abdomen and it will be cured with medicines and nothing to worry about that. So, he's really happy. So what I feel is, doctor, if he's happy and confident, he may be able to do better at home. He may not be panicky. He may get good sleep. So if we tell him this about this disease, he may become panic. And I don't know. I'm really afraid, doctor.
Okay, Vinita. I want to get your opinion regarding a few things. He has many things to fulfill, isn't it? Many wish to fulfill. Maybe it's either he want to plan for his children or for his wife. There may be something because you also may have many wishes and you think that, okay, I will fulfill this wish, maybe next day, and this will go on. But if I tell you that you don't have much time to live, then you will prioritize your wishes, and you will take only the most important wish, and you will make sure that these wishes are fulfilled, isn't it? So that's one thing. And another thing, suppose now he has a disease, and he has many problems like pain and things like that. So this suffering is going to be increased. So as of now, we can manage with medications. Suppose pain may not come down to zero. Sometimes he may have some pain. And at that time, he may ask you to take him to another hospital. And it may be a bigger hospital and famous doctors, and taking him from to another doctor. When he asks you, please take me to that hospital, it is not going to be beneficial for him, but can you deny that?
I totally agree to you, doctor, but I still am not really confident to handle that situation. I cannot handle
that situation. Yeah, that's true. I am just giving you some thoughts. Did he ask you anything about the disease? What is my problem?
Yeah, he just asked about the test report. So I said, already told you, like, that is, there is some kind of mass in the abdomen and it will get cured with medicine. So don't worry about that. Actually, I was trying to give him some confidence and some positivity so that he can relax there. And so I would like to see him happy, but I don't want to make him sad at any cost.
Okay. When you hide information from him, and maybe next moment you may be going out, maybe to the bathroom, and crying because you have told a lie to your husband.
Yes, I usually do that, because I told you, like, I don't want to be sad in front of him. So I will try to hold all my emotions. So I share with my sibling, but not with him. In front of him, I am always happy because I want him to be happy. So that's why.
Okay. These are few things which I wanted to discuss with you. Because this can help you to make a decision regarding, just now you told, please don't tell to the diagnosis. Without your permission, I am not going to tell. But what do you think now after hearing all this?
I still can make a decision, doctor. So I think I need some time. Maybe I have to discuss with my parents or whoever I can talk comfortably. So then maybe, I don't know, maybe I can make a decision.
I just want to tell you one more point, that even if you agree with us to tell the diagnosis to him, we are not going to tell the diagnosis subjectively. First of all, we will ask him whether you really want to know about your disease. And then we will give a warning shot, like telling that even if your disease is serious, do you want to know? Then if he agrees, then we can proceed, and we will tell him that you have been to this hospital, and there was a when the scan was taken, there was a shadow, and from the shadow we did took some cells by injection, and when doing this, we will stop at every moment. And when we feel that he is not interested to hear, by looking at another place or by body language, then we will stop there, and we will tell him that, okay, we feel that at this moment, we feel that you don't want to hear, but when you want to hear, then we can talk at any moment. So that's how we will tell the news to the your husband, not abruptly. So that's also you have to keep in mind. But I understand you are worried, and you have to talk with your relatives. And I think it's proper that you discuss with them. And maybe we will meet maybe within 2 days.
Okay, doctor.
Is that okay?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. Thank you, Anita.
So thank you, Sharat and Sunil. Thank you very much. I don't know. I mean, did you all hear everything that happened here?
Yes, sir.
Any comments or questions?
So it was a nice approach, but really a practical way of dealing with the patient. All practical questions I have with the patient, and all practical acceptable answers were given by sir.
Okay, I mean, like all the principles of communication that we talked about earlier, remember the spikes protocol, starting with the setting, finding out the level of knowledge, etc., are still relevant. The principles are the same. But there are a couple of practical things that I want to tell you. One, when a family is blocking the communication, we may start persuading him. No, but we have a duty to tell him. He has a right to know. I think starting with the arguments is a very bad strategy. Why is the wife preventing the disclosure of diagnosis? Why do you think the wife is disclosing the preventing disclosure?
She's worried that he won't be able to handle the.
Yes, absolutely. And essentially, it's because she loves him and she wants to do the best for him, right? What do you want to do? You also want to do the best for him, right? So rather than we being on two sides and arguing, like one of my teachers, Dr. Rosalie Shaw, put it this way. She said, don't be like two tennis players on two sides of the court. One serving and the other returning. It never ends. Jump over the net. Go to the patient's court. Play together. So, let me tell you how I see that jumping over the net happens. So, what was the girl's name? Vinita. Vinita, you do look a bit worried. You want to tell me about it? You are not proceeding with your agenda of breaking bad news. You remember that Vinita is also your client, the person whom you are going to help. Palliative care is for not only for the husband, it's also for Vinita. It's primarily for the patient and secondarily for the family, I agree, but she is also somebody who is suffering. So I have a duty to her also. You want to tell me about it? Give her an opportunity to talk. That's one important thing. And consider this sentence. Vinita, you are suffering a lot because of your love for your husband. You want to do the best for him. And she may say, yes, 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 doctor, my children are only 7 years and 4 years old. We need him. We cannot afford to lose him. I may respond to that by saying, Vinita, my colleagues and I also want to do the best for him. Believe me, we want to do the best for him. And I promise that we will do everything we can to help him and you. That's the process of jumping over the net and go into her side that I am talking about. You want to do the best, I also want to do the best for you. Let us work together. Together we will see how best we can help you. That's first step. Then, do you think he has been, asking you about the diagnosis? That's a possible question. Did he ever tell, when he asked, how did he frame the question? Did he seem anxious about it? Okay, you have been treating him here all this time. Did he start asking you, shall we go elsewhere, I am not getting better, anything like that? Do you think it is necessary? Do you think he would have many things to accomplish before he becomes very ill? Do you think he will have unfinished business with his job, with his business? Do you think there is anything that he really wants to do? Has he ever talked about that? So these are some questions which may, from the Vinita's side, bring out the problems of not knowing you. She may say, yes, he's about 7 times every day, he's asking, what do I have, what did the doctors tell you? And on surface, he was actually, I see that my voice is breaking. No? Not now, okay. Vinita herself will say, well, once or twice she was very angry with me and said, you are hiding something, what is it? So I may point then out to Vinita, look Vinita, I don't know how good an actor you are, but very often our face changes when we are telling a falsehood. It will be different from your face when you are telling the truth. He may be suspecting something. Do you think he is suspecting something? That's a good question. So that she brings out another problem. What other consequences are there of not knowing the truth? Will she want to go to another hospital? Will he say, let us go to Ayurveda? Let us go to Mumbai? And if he has expressed that sort of wish, by not explaining the truth, he may have to undertake difficult journeys. He may have to waste a lot of time. And I may ask, things about his job, or about, has he expressed any wish about things that he wants to do? Well, she may say, well, he actually always wanted to take the children to Ooty, but we never got around to doing that. So we ourselves then may point out, well, if he gets proper pain management and comes to know that this is the truth, he may be able to fulfill his wishes when he is well enough. So these arguments I'll come to only after hearing her side, acknowledging that I want to do the best for him and for her. And then I may try to tell her. But after all this, she may still say, no, don't tell him. What shall we do then? I don't know what happens in Delamy's country, but it is possible that in many countries, people may say, well, he has a right to know. And if he asks, do you want me to lie to him? I cannot possibly lie to him. But here the wife may say, of course, you must tell a lie to him because this is a white lie. It's for his good. So what I might then do is, okay, you do not want me to tell him everything. But give me permission for one thing. Let me first find out what his perception is. He'll just explore and find out what he knows. So even when the person is preventing disclosure, I may be able to get a permission to find out what he knows. And if the person still says, no, I may insist, look, he seemed very anxious to me. The anxiety can be very bothersome for him. We must explore further. We must find out the source of his anxiety. Please allow me to ask him a few questions. And later, even if they, very often if I explore, the patient himself may say, oh, they think I don't know, but I know I have cancer, doctor. It happens very frequently. But even if that does not happen and the person is preventing disclosure, I may get partial permission for disclosure. That's okay. Today, I will never tell him. Today, I will not tell him he has cancer. But let me find out what he wants to know, how much he knows, and let me give only enough information to relieve his anxiety. So, in that negotiation, I may bring up the question of incurability. I may bring out the word of tumor. But if the person then asks me, doctor, is that cancer? I would say, why did you ask the question? I know that many patients do have many tumors are cancer. And what did that thought make you feel? Well, they may say different things, like if it's cancer, I don't want to live. And I may then decide that today is not the time to tell him he has cancer. I may just tell him, well, it is a tumor. The nature of the tumor, let me go through your records again and I may come back to it later on another day. But for now, let us decide on the treatment. You do require this kind of treatment. Will you get us permission to proceed with this? And I may wait for a couple of days before giving the full information to you. Most of the time, we are able to get permission from the families over a few days for disclosure of the diagnosis. But that is not an answer to fit every person. Just like we have failure with many modalities of treatment, in communication also, sometimes we may not achieve our objective. Sometimes, in anger, the family may even take the patient away. That's a very sad situation. Doesn't usually happen, but rarely those things happen. Well, I'll first take your question and then see if Sunil or Delamy have some comments to offer. Any questions? Somaraju, any comments or questions?
Sir, the way you said, despite the denial or refusal from the family side regarding conveying the truth to the patient, sir, the approach what you said, jumping over the net and then going towards the other side, and then the ability to get from the family, that jointly we are trying to help the patient, and then we are absolutely with you in helping the patient. So this approach is really, really, it can really make our way easy to help the patient, sir. Disclosing the truth, sir. This kind of intervention in communication. First time I'm hearing this. This appears very, very meaningful, and also most as you rightly said. most of the times we may succeed in this, and we will also remember the fact rarely we may also fail, sir. But this is a very, very good approach. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. So, Mirajee, thank you. And point that I want to emphasize there is one thing I may not have said is building a relationship with that candidate. The person who is blocking the disclosure, considering himself, considering us their enemy, now we should become friendly so that the person may himself tomorrow after 3 days say, "Doctor, we don't know what to, what should I do?" That's the time when we are able to influence the more. Anybody else? Bharat?
Sir, we in our discussion we had approached the family to know about the patient's perspective about the disease and whether we should disclose him or not. But we had also discussed that the first right is of the patient, and he may have his right to reserve the information with himself and not the family. So if we are engaging the family first, are we not violating that right of not disclosing the information to his or her family?
Very important point, Bharat, because we have a legally...
Sir, I am not able to hear you. Not able to hear you, sir.
Hello, how about now?
Yes, sir. Now it's better, sir. Yes, sir.
Legally, look, this is my body. I have more right over this than anybody else. If my wife or son comes to you and says, "Don't tell me," you still have the duty to be primary responsibilities for me. Legally. That is totally undisputed. Let me take it one step further. Ethically, you have a duty to do the best for me. Ethically, if you acknowledge that you have to do the best for me, then the truth is, by taking that stand to the family, he has a right to know. I have a duty to tell him. I am going to tell him. You and my family are now enemies. Do you think you will be able to help me till my death? Or are you likely to lose me as a patient? So, doing that legally right thing immediately may actually be doing harm to me, because you are the kind doctor who are in a position to tell me. By taking me away from you, because I am powerless at that time, I'm a sick man, my family will still... I love my family, I don't want to antagonize them either. But I may go with them, find an aggressive oncologist who may still give me trouble by giving me chemotherapy when it's not helpful. So, though you are legally doing, engaging my autonomy, in practice, you may lose the opportunity to help me. I may lose the opportunity to be helped by you. This happens because in our country, the family's autonomy is more than very often the family's autonomy in West. The individual's autonomy in practice in our country is often less than a Westerner's individual autonomy. The family together is a closer unit. And it's a conflict. If it comes to the legal issue, the patient says, "Dr. Bharat, you tell me what I have a right to know." Then I may explain to the family, "You know, he is correct. If he really wants to know, I have the duty to tell him. And I may disclose the diagnosis." But that is when the person is insisting on that truth. If the person looks a rather helpless doctor, "Please tell me what I have," I may still say, "Okay, we'll talk about it, I'll come back to you," and try to persuade the family. I think that approach respects my or satisfies my needs more than the absolute rights-based approach. It's a conflict, like in many ethical dilemmas, the answers are not very clear. What I said may be very unacceptable to another person. Okay, the concluding message from me is, as far as possible, keep on trying to achieve consensus. Disclose the news with the family's intervention, with the concurrence as far as possible. But when the patient insists on knowing, well, then I agree. Even if the family does not agree, after giving them explanations, why you have a legal and moral right to help him, you might tell him. I try to avoid that situation, that crisis, as much as possible by engaging the family as much as possible.
Sir, still some doubt is persisting.
Yes.
Persisting.
Yes.
I was confused regarding whom to disclose first. We were taking opinion of the family, opinion of the person from the family, what is his perspectives, and gradually we will disclose the information. Secondly, the person may not want his family to disclose, although we know that family support will be an important issue for proper care. But some may resist the information being delivered to the family. So whom to disclose this information first? If we disclose it to family and get their opinion or consent that, okay, now we will disclose to the patient, then patient may disagree with that. If he comes to know later that my family knows, I didn't want to disclose them. Secondly, if we tell the patient first and later, family can say that, okay, we didn't want to, although patient has the right to know, but whom to approach first, with first the patient or the family, try to build consensus, but whom is that, if the patient approaches first, we should deliver him the information and later convince him that, okay, we'll convince your family also because their help is will be needed for your good care. Or if the family approaches first, okay, you tell us, then we will decide whether to tell the patient or not. So whom to disclose this information first and prepare the other for the consequences.
Okay, first, before answering the question, apologies, I have overrun time. It's already past 5. Secondly, another apology in advance. After answering this question, I will have to leave the room. I would request Delemi and Sunil to take over and answer any questions that anybody who still wants to remain may have, because I know it's a difficult question. So this is my stand here. I am very glad, Bharat, that you brought out that point, because I failed to convey an important message to you, and you have brought it up. Very often, we start talking to the family. That is not to do. This particular discussion was based on Vinita's husband, in which case Vinita and the family were blocking the conversation. My primary objective is the quality of life of the patient. I will first convey everything to the patient. I will start talking to the patient. This business of considering the patient a piece of furniture and always talking to the family is totally unacceptable. As far as possible, we should be interacting with the patient directly. And if the patient is directly interacting with us, all my conversation will be with him or her primarily and with the family only secondarily. Absolutely no doubt about it. Now, when very often, as very often happens, the family is coming and blocking the diagnosis, that's another issue altogether. That is what this discussion was all about. Bharat, I am very grateful to you for bringing in the patient. Our conversation should not be to the patient as much as possible and not about the patient to somebody else. Thank you very much, Bharat.
Thank you, sir.
Will you please take the seat and continue any answering any important questions that we have? So sorry that I have to run away like this. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for the session.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Hello. Hello.
Yeah, hello.
I have one question.
Yes.
What if the family wants to take the patient away without telling the diagnosis? Then what to do?
So you mean that the family doesn't allow us to tell the diagnosis?
Yeah, it doesn't allow us, and they want to take the patient home, never to come back. Then what to do?
No, we don't have. I think we don't have any other choice, because if they want to take the patient, then we should allow him to go. We don't have any other choice. Maybe we can.
We should tell the patient.
No, we can't go and go against the wish of the patient, caregiver, and tell it to the patient. And what you have to understand is managing collision or managing communicating bad news is not a one-time procedure. It will take time.
Yeah.
So I don't think that with one conversation we have solved all the things. It will take some time. So maybe you can ask them when we meet next time. We will talk more about this. That's what I think you can do.
So you're saying that if the family wants to take the patient home without telling him the diagnosis, so we can allow them without telling the patient.
Yeah, you can. You can also note it in the case sheet that you have discussed with the caregiver, and they are not willing to divulge the diagnosis to the patient.
Okay. Right. Thank you.
Because, sir, once we have documented in the case sheet that patient is has this diagnosis and his caregivers are not allowing him to disclose the diagnosis, once they are discharged home, later, sooner, when some other complication happens, and just skip that, we'll advise the patient relative also that wherever he goes for any other additional complaints he is having, please take these documents with them so that the other person can judiciously optimize the treatment. So if we document these things in this, the other caregiver will, the other treating physician will also come to know about these things. And by that time, he may again do this re-counseling, and probably at that time, they may, the family must may agree to communicate this information. So documentation with the advice given to the relatives to take care of these investigations and file wherever they approach for any other complication to some other patient.
It was a comment, isn't it,
everybody? Yeah, sir. It was a comment. Okay. It was not a question.
Yeah.
Just in continuation of what...
Anybody else? So I think the message is that the communication, like managing pollution or communicating bad news, it is not a one-time procedure. It will take time. So be patient and work with the family to get a consensus regarding the things. And then if many families with us, then it is easy for us to communicate to the patient regarding anything. Hello? Then we will stop for today and meet you on Thursday. So the next topic is difficult pain.